Now, the video introduction that you have just seen concluded with these words: I am alive like you, and I am standing beside you. Close your eyes and look around. You will see me in front of you. These were the words written by Gibran himself to be placed on his final resting place. And these beautiful and haunting words are truly words of encouragement. So with Gibran's spirit undoubtedly here in front of us tonight, we arrive at the keynote presentation. But before we start, we need to ask a question. Why? Why did the Australian Lebanese Foundation invite Jonar Nader to present the keynote address? I mean, there must have been dozens of scholars and academics and eminent dignitaries who could have been considered. So what is it about Jonar that makes him the obvious choice? Well, maybe it's because both Jonar and Gibran have a great deal in common. Both men have mothers who were born in the village of Pjari. Both Gibran and Jonar played in the same fields, and they climbed the same trees, ate fruit from the same orchards, drank from the same streams. As a boy, Gibran was taken to the United States, and as a boy, Jonar was brought here to Sydney. Both men could not speak English when they changed countries, yet both men went on to become international authors and both write poetically. In fact, Jonar also writes about crime and terrorism and high technology and management. I'm sure that a great deal of you have been listening to Jonar on Arabic and English radio for the last 20 years. Gibran was fond of painting, and Jonar too is an artist. Of the 24 paintings in Jonar's home, Jonar painted all 24 of them. Both men infuriate people. Both upset people. And both challenge leaders in government and in industry. And both men have changed people's lives with their literary work. Now, you heard the president of the Australian Lebanese Foundation, Professor Fadia Hossein, say that Jonar was the little Gibran. We could think of no one better qualified to present the keynote address here tonight to celebrate Gibran's life. Ladies and gentlemen, to explore the genius of Gibran, we would like to call on our own resident genius. Ladies and gentlemen, please, a big round of applause for Mr. Jonar Nader.
Thank you, Greg.
You're welcome.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, members of my family from Shirley, it's so lovely to see you. I wanted to just give us all a little bit of a question here. Was Gibran a genius? That's a question that some journalists asked me the other day. So that's going to be the question I will pose. Now, you all know he's fantastic, you all know he's great, you all know he's brilliant, but we've got to find the proof, because anyone can say, oh, you're brilliant, you're fantastic, but where's the proof? So I'd like to talk to you about the proof today. But before we begin, just for those of us who might have forgotten where Lebanon is, well, you all know where Italy is, don't you? Okay, now this is the Mediterranean Sea, and Lebanon has the best view on the Mediterranean. You get this very straight, wonderful view. Now, what does Lebanon look like? It's sort of smothered away there. It's cozy, Minister Wadi, isn't it, being Lebanon, surrounded by these wonderful nations around us. And let me just ask you, if we compare Lebanon with Australia, where do you think, look at this, where do you think that Lebanon would fit? No, not there. I was showing this to someone and they said, really, I didn't think it was that big. No, here it is. This is Lebanon fitting in Australia for you. If you were to start in Newcastle and drive down, you wouldn't even get to Wollongong because it's just a short drive, and I do that every day, you know, from where I live down, and I take tolls as well. Now, this was where I was born, in the city space of Lebanon, but my mother came from Shadley, and that was her environment. And to look, oh yes, the Shadley Association, welcome. Now, to find my mum's house, because I used to go there, and I grew up there, and I played there, this photo couldn't quite get it. So it's actually to the bottom left of this photo, and I had to hire a commercial Russian satellite to show me the house, and zoom in on it. Now, this was where they grew up, our cousins, uncles, they used to have parties left, right, centre. Now, for you to understand how magnificent this property was, I need to peel away the frame. And we used to go there and enjoy the lunches and the dinners and the most freshest of food. And if you thought that was fantastic, hold your breath as you look out the balcony and think... If you were even brave a little bit more, you'd go further and further and further. Now, when you have these views from Chadwick, the next question has to be, if you were standing there, what would you see? And the views, both in summer and winter, were the most stunning of views. You can see why people in Lebanon and people from Lebanon absolutely love their country, because whether it's summer or winter, it is delightful. And I used to go there as a child, and at the age of six, here I am, someone said to me, quick, let's go. And I thought, oh, another adventure, because they were always saying, quick, let's go. And this time they took me to the museum of Gibran Khalil Gibran. And I was, there it is, that was the photo. And I was this young kid walking to this thing that was a monastery and is now a beautiful museum. And I thought, what is this? And people were cheering, saying, wow, Jonah's been introduced to Gibran. Well, friends, since I was 13, I fell in love with his work. And when I was 16, to this day, I read his book, The Prophet, twice a year. And every time I read it, I think, how stupid can I be? I'm still learning. And I read the book and I think, oh, I didn't know that. I still learn from his work day and night. So let me now get to the question. Was Gibran a genius? Well, let's see if we can even prove this point. First, I believe that to be a genius, you have to be an original thinker. Because if everyone's like you, where's the genius in that, right? So was Gibran an original thinker? On marriage in the Prophet, when he wrote and we read and he said, stand together, yet not too near together, for the pillars of the temple stand apart. Wow. He was saying that at a time when no one would dare even utter those words, let alone think them, in a culture that was completely different. Was that original or what? And was that daring or what? He said, even though they quiver with the same music, the strings of the lute are alone. For a man so young, he died at 48, don't forget, if I'm right. Is that right?
Yes.
For a man so young to dare to utter these words about marriage, that says to me, he was thinking in a way that was original. That's proof point number one. Was this man ahead of his time? Well, you know, I was watching an interview with Buzz Aldrin, one of the men who were the first to walk on the moon. And I remember Buzz Aldrin saying something like, when we left this earth and I look back, I could not see the geography that I was taught at school. At school, we're taught with these maps, and you see this map. And he said, but when I looked at the earth, I couldn't see the geography. It was just one beautiful planet, one beautiful place. Why on earth do we have conflict when we're a little tiny, tiny dot in the universe? And now this was a gentleman who had to spend $2 billion to get to the moon to work that out. And here is Gibran, 46 years prior, having noticed this before the aeroplane, before the space shuttle, before anyone ever thought we'd ever get to the moon. Gibran's mind was elevating to the satellite status. And he said, you know, if you were to sit upon a cloud, you would not see the boundary line between one country and another, nor the boundary stone between one farm and the next. Gibran said, it is a pity you cannot sit upon a cloud. Basically saying, stupid people, what are you fighting about? We're all one nation, we're all one country, we're all one earth, we're all one globe that should be pulling together. And he was indeed a man of peace, as Minister Wadley was mentioning. So, do you think he was ahead of his time when long before even anyone could conceive of the rocket or the spaceship that he could actually conceive that we really ought to just spend a moment and look down and see how funny it is? He was shifting power before the feminist movement started, and before the women's rights movement started, and he was talking about equality before anyone dared utter those words, and he said, are you a husband who regards the wrongs he has committed as lawful, but those of his wife as unlawful? At a time when men were dominant and dominating? Or are you a faithful companion whose wife is ever at his side, sharing his every thought, rapture, and victory? Long before the women's movement, long before the equal rights movement, this was a man way ahead of his time, shifting power. Perhaps the fourth proof point, we ask, okay, to be a genius, I think you need to be somewhat innovative. Well, were you? Was he innovative? Let us look at some of this question. Back then, and to this very day, everyone thinks that work is always work. And back then, long before the management gurus and the total quality management and the ISO 9002 quality assurance, and long before all this please staff engagement, so let's go play golf at Noosa and let's hug each other, and I don't know what they do in these corporate things, you know, you all go to them. People saw work, as they still see work sometimes, as a burden. And way back then, was this not innovative or not, when he said, people, work is love made visible. And he was the guru talking about management, staff engagement, and talking about everything that you do. You must do it with passion and with love, not because it makes you feel better, but because you are doing it for someone who is your kin, your friend, your family. We are all one family. Build a house as if you were building it for your mother. What about proof point number five? Was he brave? Boy, was he brave to speak like this at a time when no one even dared speak like this. You know they used to burn his books in the city square. Here we are celebrating the man that has touched our lives, and back then some audacious person, especially in the churches, were burning his books. No disrespect, Your Excellency. I don't think you'd do that today, would you? Well, he certainly was brave, and he knew that he would probably be killed if he went back home, because he was back in the US and people were ostracizing him out of the country. And he loved it. I mean, he was at pains with it and he was dying with it. But he said, I now know I've touched a nerve, and when you touch a nerve, you're getting close to something that's called truth. And therefore, that's okay. I'll forego my beautiful homeland, but I'd rather do what I have to do. And he said of these empires who were dominating Lebanon, he said, the ignorant nations arrest their good men and turn them into despots. Because that's what they were trying to do to him, saying, oh, he's a nobody. A country ruled by a tyrant persecutes those who try to free the people from the burden of slavery. They were persecuting him because he was saying, stop allowing anyone to oppress you. And he who does not prefer exile to slavery is not free by any measure of freedom. He was free in his mind, and he would not let anyone censor him, even if that meant being deprived from his very own home. Was Gibran a genius? Well, a genius needs to be insightful. And was he indeed insightful when he said these words, which I wish I learned a long time ago? That's what I tell you. I think I'm stupid because I'm still learning. I wish I knew this before. Gentlemen, how long did it take you to learn this? Gibran said, listen to a woman when she looks at you, not when she speaks to you. A long time to work that out. You see, I'm so literal. I hear words, and I go, no, it's got nothing to do with the words, and the man sorted that out. Let's get proof point number seven going. Did he achieve amazing results? Well, some would measure results today commercially by how many books did he sell, how many movies did he make, was he in the top 10, and what does the XYZ newspaper top 10 book sales? It does not matter. He doesn't care whether he sells one book or, as it so happens now, millions of books. He did achieve amazing results, and the result that I think is amazing is that Gibran could kiss you and hit you at the same time. He could love you and chastise you and slap you, and yet you know that he's doing it with love. He was able to stir our mind into thinking into ways that no one ever dared utter, and yet at the same time, while he stirred our mind, he was touching our heart. That is a skill that I do not know too many writers can do. He himself suffered personal challenges. And if you cannot overcome a personal challenge, you can never get to the status of success, let alone the status of genius. I mean, as you know, anything you do, you're all very successful people in this room. You know nothing is easy. Everyone looks at you and they go, oh, you're so successful. Only you know the hundreds of millions of hours and heart and blood pressure and blood, sweat and tears that you pour into it. And he himself had tremendous personal challenges. Going to a new country, a new language, it was his, mum was sick and his brother died and his father was in jail. And like, it was just really tumultuous and difficult. But he himself, as you know, died early. He actually died unconscious at St. Vincent's Hospital in New York. That's how much pain he was in. The medications back then weren't as lucky as they are today, you know, or as great as they are today. But did he know pain? My goodness. He said, pain is an unseen and powerful hand that breaks the skin of the stone in order to extract the pulp. Now, my friend Suzanne Mansour brought this to my attention, and we discussed this for ages. Can you see a man so in pain that he thinks that pain, first of all, is unseen? You can't arrest it, because if you know where it is, you can go and grab it and kick it. But no, it's just all over, but it's unseen. So that means you can't do anything about it. It engulfs you, and it's so powerful that the stone all of a sudden can be ripped like as if it were a fig or a mango. And the stone can be pulped. My goodness, that's crushing. And he suffered that. And yet he did not give up. He did not go on the dole. He did not sort of go, oh, woe is me. He persisted and persisted and would not give up. And he continued. But how did he continue? He continued through a maze that was the most difficult of all. He could have, for example, said, let's go to war against these people. But he didn't. He could have said, I'll be a dictator and make it my way or no way, and if you don't do it my way, you're in trouble. He didn't do that either. Gibran stirred the world, but he didn't intimidate anybody. He didn't study theology in a sense, he didn't enter religious life, and he could have, and he could have been very useful, but he didn't. He chose something harder. He wasn't a police officer, nor was he an outlaw. Outlaws change the world for us. Law enforcers help us to improve our lot. He was neither. I wish he'd chosen one of those. Life would have been easier, but no, he chose an even harder life. Did he go into law? Did he become a judge? No. He could have done and been a great one at it. He could have been a philanthropist or a generous man, but he didn't have the money. He could have built things and infrastructures. He couldn't do it. Had he have done that, it would have been easier. He chose an even harder path. He didn't go for rallies and demonstrations, and he didn't enter Parliament. What did he do? He could have done any of those and been powerful, but he chose the worst one of those, and that is the arts. The arts is the most difficult way in which to communicate and embrace people, yet the most loving and the most penetrating, as the Honourable Virginia Judge mentioned. Oh, we need to start speaking in culture rather than war and money, and get into the hearts and minds of people, because that's where they live, not in their bank account. No disrespect to our friends from the Commonwealth Bank and the Arab Bank. But you know, James, you would agree, wouldn't you? Family, love and heart. Not about how much money you've got. So he didn't choose any of those, he chose the arts. And now here's the punchline to this problem. Not only did he choose the arts, he chose the most difficult of all the arts. What did he choose? He chose writing. Of course, he was a painter too, but his painting could not exist without his works. I mean, every work of art that he has produced is relevant to his poetry, to his philosophy. So he was a writer. And I'm saying to you that being a writer is the most difficult of all the arts. So what a problem this man has put on his shoulders. Now, can I prove to you that writing is the most difficult of all the arts? Because that seems strange, doesn't it, Dr. Toke? Because anyone can pick up a pen and paper. Isn't that fantastic? Anyone can, roses are red, violets are blue, hello darling, how are you? I mean, it's very simple. There you go, publish that. Well, let's see now. Can we prove this point? I think food is an art. And growing up with my mother, who's here tonight, and she's the best cook in the world, I'm sure your mother is too. To me, food is fantastic, and she feeds me day and night, and I think, wow. Now, food is an art, you must admit. You can't say to a chef, there you go, here are nine pieces of lettuce, do something. Yeah. But the thing is that though food is delicious, the beginning points of food come from Mother Nature, come from God. And we take what God has given us and we turn it into delicious tabbouleh, falafel and everything else you want. Now, but you know, I don't watch television, but I know on TV they have these shows about the greatest chef or whatever. I think, what are you boasting about? God made the tomato. Well, who do you think you are? So yeah, of course we can have good chefs and bad chefs, but see what they've got to begin with. They have a wonderful foundation to begin with. What does a writer have to begin with? I've got to ask you. Here we have Mother Nature's own beauty that gives the chef a good lift, a good starting point. What does the writer have? The writer has unnatural language. I look at a human and I think bones and fingers and teeth and eyes. Isn't it amazing that the biology of a human can actually see, can hear, can feel, but yet I don't understand how we're born with no language. Language has to be taught, and you have to learn it, and we have had thousands and still have thousands of languages, and now a writer has to communicate to you, to me, through an unnatural process. There are only three natural things to do with communication. One of them is crying. I find that funny too. Can you imagine a meeting with God? And he's having this committee, like the Australian Peace Foundation, 5 years sitting at the table, and she's running this committee. And so God's having one like this, and he's having a discussion. He says, I want to create this human, and I want them to cry. Someone like me would say, what for? What's crying all about? That's one. That's the only thing we have in common. The second thing we have in common is screaming. Of all the languages in the world, we all know screaming. I think that's a very universal piece of language. And what is screaming? It's when the brain goes into overdrive and it cannot think anymore, it goes into its natural state. Now watch this little video here of this girl on the right-hand side. She gets to the point where she doesn't know what to say. Her natural instincts take over. Watch how she screams in desperation.
Go, darling, I'm calling you on the way back to the office. Take your mobile. Off you go, 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 go. Right? Cancel that meeting and tell them anyway nobody likes me then they won't like what I have to say, but I'll just say it anyway, then they can do what they want and I'm sure it'll be great. But if you could, what, just go! Go on!
Well, they want to speak to you!
Oh, and now we're getting feedback. Now I tell them I haven't got time.
That's what happens. You just get to the point of no more words, and that's the natural state. And the other one is laughter. It's a very funny little engineering thing, that we laugh, we cry, we scream. They're the only things we have in common. And so the writer doesn't have beautiful tomato and burbul and za'atar and all these things to work with. The writer has nothing and has to work with a manufactured language to somehow then go into meaning. And somehow I'm supposed to think it, feel it, and then somehow express it to you and give it to you, and while you're on the train or on the bus, you're somehow going to get the same feeling. I don't know. That makes it very difficult. So, by comparison to cooking, the writer has it tough. What about in comparison to, say, the fine artist? Indeed, the fine artist can take a simple piece of lead and turn it into a lovely illustration of what Captain Cook saw and what life was like. But the great thing about that is that the artist has the privilege of colour. So much so that we can mix and mix and create wonderful creations. And I'm not putting down the arts in this sense at all, but I'm saying, isn't the fine artist so lucky that they have colour? What does Gibran have? What does a writer have? They don't have anything other than maybe the exclamation mark, you know, maybe the question mark. And if you want to be so bold, you put colour, but I'm not sure what that does. You're restricted. What about then, let's compare the writer to the engineer and the architect. Oh, it takes a great mind to build the Harbour Bridge, the Opera House, a wonderful building. Imagine the beauty. This world has developed so beautifully through architecture. But I say to you, the author has it tougher than the architect, because when this bridge was built, it was built once. You don't have people driving up to, you know, North Sydney and then getting out their hammers and whatever and building a bridge again. It's built for them. But for a writer, when they present the book to you, you have to read it and construct it in your head every single time. Every single passenger who comes to any of Gibran's book has to read it and construct it in their head every single time. That makes it difficult for the writer, because they don't know where you're at, what you're thinking about, your level of understanding, and the writer is useless, pointless. It's a dead piece of paper until you reconstruct it every single time. That makes it pretty tough. Then we have to compare the writer with the movie maker. Now, in the movie world, you've got multimedia, special effects, sound, colour, movement, many, many actors, location. Isn't that marvellous? And yes, movie making is difficult, it's rich, but It's so much easier because you've got all the richness of multimedia and computer animation. What does a writer have? 26 letters of the alphabet if you're speaking in English. Now, you've got to take 26 letters of the English alphabet and somehow put them and give them to someone who's on a train or on a bus somewhere far away from you, and that person has to reconstruct the bridge in their head and feel it and change their life with it or change their world with it. But I actually say you don't have 26 letters of the English alphabet. If you take some of the greatest features of the world, and this could be a hobby. Those of you who do crosswords, you can now have a new hobby. You grab any famous speech you like this Abraham Lincoln Gettysburg Address. The last line says, a most impactful speech, government of the people, for the people, by the people. But that's not 26 letters, it's 44 characters, but if you actually look at those, there are 11 E's and 6 O's. So when you strip all the doubles away, you end up with not 44 characters, but simply 14. And somehow in 14 characters, I've got to marshal an army, or stop a war, or change your life with 14 characters of the alphabet somewhere when you're on a train and I can't be there with you and expect you to rebuild it in your mind. That is difficult. You've all heard this.
And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
Indeed, these were the words from Gibran himself. And Gibran wrote these words when John F. Kennedy was 8 years old. And John F. Kennedy used those words, but he was ill-advised. Because John F. K. was saying, my fellow citizens, ask not, in his American, what your country can... Gibran didn't mean that. This is from a long essay, that's a beautiful essay called The New Frontier. You can easily find it on the internet. Gibran's actually talking to the likes of President JFK. How dare the President turn it back on the people? Gibran was saying to the President, don't you get into public power and position and work, think that this is for you, mate. You're there to serve your people. And the next sentence was, and if you're a member of the church or clergy, for goodness sake, you're not there to fatten your belly, you're there to serve the others. Truly, there's Gibran's words, and I'll tell you, I would hate to tell you what he said about corporations and banks, but really, he is saying, look outwards and stop looking inwards. Okay, so, we've got 26 letters or 14 letters of the English alphabet that I have to string together, or the writer does, and gives them to you, and they're dead until you construct them, and that has to evoke emotion and evoke action. Is that hard work or what? Because it could have been just easier to start a war, wouldn't it? Easier just to become a dictator, do as I say. Is that difficult or what? Okay, I know there are mathematicians in the room who will say to me, oh no, maths is much harder. Maths is infinitely harder than English and writing. Well, let's have a look at this question. Indeed, when you look at an equation or any sort of problem at school, you would see something like this. X minus A times X minus B times X minus C times X minus D times X minus C. Now, if you had to sit there and work that out, you'd have to write this out like this, and the teacher would give you 10 out of 10. That's fantastic. And then you go to the next grade, and the teacher says, hang on, now you've got to multiply that by X minus F. And then you write it all out and look like this. And then when you get to a little bit higher, tell you how much higher, 15 years old. When you get to 15 years old, they give you this equation, and it says go all the way to Z. Well, to go all the way to Z, you would need 134 million phrases, and really that's about 670,000 pages. So indeed you could say maths is much harder, but no, maths is easier, because when I say to you what's 100 times 2, you don't sit there counting 101, 102, 100, do you? We have shortcuts. And you know when I say to you 100 times 2, you know it's 200. You don't sit there working it out. And when I show you this, you're not going to sit there and write 670,000 pages. Because if you did, it would look like this. These now are 670,000 pages. You wouldn't. A child of 15 who knows algebra can work that out in 2 minutes. Yet an author who writes a complete shelf of 670,000 pages, is there a shortcut in literature? What is the shortcut? There isn't. And no child of 15 can read those books and work it out in 2 minutes. Music. Hang on, perhaps music is harder than writing. Well, when a musician writes something or composes something, they don't give you a keyboard and say, there you go, darling, I've composed something for you. No, they play it for you. And not only does a musician play one note at a time, they can put their entire 10 fingers on a keyboard and play. A writer cannot put 10 anything and play, because if a writer had a thought and wanted another thought on top of it, it would look like this. It's just impossible. But a musician can have 10, 20, 30, 60 pieces in an orchestra to play with you. And the other fantastic thing is this, that in music, you have a beat. When a writer writes, you are far away from them. And here we are, decades later from Gibran, decades later. And we are expected to read Gibran's work and know the beat, and that is tough. So it takes a very skilled writer to be able to write and quiver and beat your heart so that you can get into the rhythm of the philosophy. Now, how many people in the audience can play this? This is called the tabla, is it, Bucky? And this gives us the beat. And I have for you an expert in this area who's going to demonstrate how this works so I can show you how, in fact, music is so much easier than writing. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome Nabil Shah to play the tabla for us. Come on, Nabil. Show us how this works.
Some percussion, so we'll bring out the duff. Khalid, please join us on stage. And for the soul, we need the nai. The nai is the flute. Can you please welcome Tony Shalita on the nai?
Sculpture harder than writing? Well, you see, the brilliant thing about sculpture is that it is, in fact, three-dimensional, but you can start looking at a piece of art from any which way you like. Three-dimensional. Whereas the writer has to suffer the flat process of one word at a time. Now, can I show you what would happen if the writer gets it in the wrong order? You see, with a sculpture, you can start anywhere you like. With writing, you cannot start anywhere you like. You have to start at the same spot. Because if you start to mean something, say I'm a great teacher, and if you don't get those in the right order, you're really saying I'm a great cheater. You might go to your bank and say, really, I'd like a debit card, but then you might actually accidentally say to them, I have bad credit. Sequence is vital, and you have to be patient enough with the sequence. Now, the most wonderful of pieces of architecture in terms of sculpture for me is the tree. I would be walking, so I know I don't fall over more often, because I'm always looking up and I think trees are just absolutely marvellous when it comes to sculpture and God's creation. Now, the tree of Lebanon is the cedar tree, the Alzib, as we call it. And, you know, Lebanon's name comes from this sight, from this vision, that we see white. And the word Lebanon comes from the word Lebanon, which means Laban, which means white, which hence we say Laban yogurt is white. And this was the vision of this white. Lebanon's the only country in the Middle East that doesn't have a desert. And whether it's summer or whether it's winter, it is divine to see this cedar tree. And this is the tree that really represents Lebanon on the flag, the Lebanese flag. Now, there was a Lebanese cedar tree in Sydney at the Royal Botanic Gardens that was donated to Sydney 100 years, 126 years ago. And this tree is the one donated from Lebanon, and here it is in Sydney, but unfortunately the roots got into salt water and it had to be chopped down. So word got out, and this lady in red, you see, was interrupting someone who's trying to take wedding photos, and she's saying, what? They're tearing that down. And that lady was Lama Murad, and she called her husband in, and he comes in a little bit later and he says, oh my goodness, how could we chop this tree down? He knew it had to be done, but he also heard it was going to be pulped. And he said, not over my dead body, you wouldn't pulp it. So he waited until they chopped it down. And what did he do with it? He took it home. And he rescued this tree all the way from Lebanon. It sat in Sydney for 126 years. And he began to ponder and write and think and draw until he came up with some sketches. Now, Tom Murad has been a sculptor in his head since the age of 8, and he entered the profession at the age of 19. And he then began to sculpt. And would you like to see what he has sculpted? Ladies and gentlemen, I shall unveil for you the wonderful work of the very cedar tree by Tom Murad. And Lama Murad and Tom Murad are with us today on chapter on table 25. We can give them a round of applause. You can come later. Lama has the job also of naming them, and she called this Rebirth. And this is one piece from the cedar tree. In fact, Tom has 50 pieces from that cedar tree. Now, as I conclude, Gibran knew that writing was difficult. He knew that communication was difficult. And his only solution at the end was to say to his friends, I wish we could condense the language to 7 words. He knew that it was very difficult to communicate, and he sure tried his best and he succeeded, did he not? What were those 7 words that he believes are at the core of humanity. I shall share them with you and will encourage you to speak about this with your friends. Let us see which were the seven words that Gibran chose. You, I, give, God, love, beauty, and earth. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I hope that in this short time that I have brought you along with me to the proof points that Gibran, in my book certainly, was a genius. There are no more speeches beyond me. You will soon be enjoying your dessert, and I thank you very much for having me.
I would just like, on behalf of the University of Sydney and the Australian Lebanese Foundation and everybody who's here tonight, to say thank you very much to Jonar for a wonderful keynote address, and to also thank him for all of the commitment and care and passion that he's put into making tonight possible. I'm not sure actually where Jonar's got to. I think we're talking to presentation.
Thank you very much. Wow. These are the children of Lebanon. They are those who migrate with nothing but courage in their hearts and arms, but who return with wealth in their hands and a wreath of glory upon their heads. Thank you very much, everybody.
I'm جلست العصر مثلي بين جفنات العنا والعناقيد تدلت كثريات الذهب هل جلست العصر مثلي بين جفنات العنا والعناقيد تدلت كثريات الذهب هل فرشت العشب لك